Hey guys, it's Professor Dave. Let's synthesize some alkynes.
He knows a lot about the science stuff, Professor Dave explains.
So when we're doing synthesis, we may, for whatever reason, want to make an alkyne. So let's look at one way that we can make alkynes. And it's not really any new chemistry. We're just going to be doing E2 reactions. We already know how to do dehydrohalogenation. So we can use a double dehydrohalogenation. We can basically do this twice on a dihalide. So we know if we have a halogen, if we have a bromine or something on an alkane, we can do an E2. But if we have two, we can do this twice. So let's look first at a situation where we have a vicinal dihalide. So a vicinal dihalide means that we have two halogens and they are on adjacent carbons. So maybe an easy way to remember that is vicinal kind of sounds like vicinity. They're in the vicinity of one another. They're adjacent. So this is a vicinal dihalide, because we have halogens that are on adjacent carbons, and we're gonna use a very strong base. We're gonna use sodamide, and so this is an extremely strong base. Just as an aside, right, sodamide, what is the conjugate acid of sodamide? That's ammonia, and ammonia itself is a base. So the conjugate acid of this base is a base. So you'd better believe that this is an extremely strong base. And so we're going to be able to do hydrohalogenation here. So let's say that we go ahead and take this guy here. Right, we've got implied hydrogens right there. Let's go ahead and take this one. And this is just an E2, right? We already know about an E2 reaction. So this is now, oops, wait, I did that the wrong way. Let's go back. I want to kick off the other one. So let's write this hydrogen here. So we're going to grab this. We're going to kick off that bromine. And so that is what is going to form this pi bond here. And we do want to point out that it is specifically going to be these hydrogens on the same carbon that bear the halogens, because they actually are more acidic. They're more acidic than the, right, we would think that maybe we could get one of these protons and make the pi bond here. But remember that these carbons have a slight partial positivity because they're connected to halogens. So if these carbons are slightly partially positive, whereas these are not, these protons are necessarily going to be more acidic because that sigma bond is going towards a partially positive carbon that is withdrawing that electron, it's pulling that electron density towards itself. So that makes those protons more acidic. So let's say we've gotten this one, we make that pi bond right here, and we kick off that bromine. So that gets us here. So we've got the alkene, but we still have one more bromine on there. And we are going to run this, we're going to use two equivalents. So if we're going to do a double dehydrohalogenation, we're going to need two equivalents of base. And so that's actually fine. We can go ahead and get this proton, and now at this point it's quite obvious that this is going to be the one that we're going to get, right? We certainly can't get one of these three because, number one, we're not going to be able to make this cumulated diene. That's not a very favorable situation to have two adjacent pi bonds like that. But second of all, an sp2 proton is certainly more acidic than sp3. So it goes sp3, pKa right around somewhere in the 50s. sp2 drops down to somewhere in the 40s. sp is somewhere around 29 or something like that. So it's really 10 orders of magnitude each time. So this is definitely the most acidic proton. So we are going to do another dehydrohalogenation. We're going to grab that proton, and we're going to make another pi bond, and we're going to kick that off. And so that's how we get to our alkyne. Remember, when we draw alkynes, we really do need to make this in linear fashion, right? Don't forget that this is a carbon, right? The carbons that are participating in the triple bond are sp hybridized, therefore they exhibit linear geometry. So we cannot draw this any longer in zigzag fashion. If you draw another pi bond right there and leave that zigzag, you know, connectivity-wise it's correct, but geometrically it's just not accurate. So we do want to draw our alkynes this way. And so there's our double dehydrohalogenation from a vicinal dihalide. We're just using two equivalents of that strong base, and we do end up with this alkyne here. So now let's look at an analogous situation. This time, let's start with a geminal dihalide. So what's a geminal dihalide? That is when the halogens, there's two halogens, right, a dihalide, two halogens, geminal, on the same carbon. So the way to remember that, geminal, think of Gemini twins. So they're kind of like twin halogens. They're on the same mother carbon, so to speak. So that's how we remember what a geminal dihalide is. And we need a specific situation where we have a geminal dihalide where the halogens are alpha to the terminus. Meaning here's the terminal carbon and they're one away. So alpha is one over terminus, alpha, and that's where the two halogens are. So that's a geminal dihalide. And this is not really gonna go that much different. It's just that we're gonna need excess. We're gonna need excess base. And so this time, let's exclusively go for these terminal protons here. So let's take our NH2 minus, and we're gonna do, this is just more sterically available. So let's go ahead and get one of these guys. We're gonna make a pi bond. We're gonna kick off one of those. And so we're going to get to here. So again, mechanistically, this is pretty much the same. We do have more base in there. So let's go ahead and do it again. And kick off that other halogen. And that's going to get us to our terminal alkyne. So we have a terminal alkyne. But the thing is, here's why we need excess base. There's not just one molecule in solution, there's many. And we need to do two dehydrohalogenations. But any time NH2 minus finds an alkyne in solution, right, and there may be an alkyne produced while some other substrate molecule has undergone only one or none, neither of the dehydrohalogenations. But if base finds this, remember, we just said earlier that sp3 protons, sp2 protons, sp protons, we're going down in pKa. sp protons are way, way more acidic than sp2 or sp3. So if strong base finds this, it is going to absolutely go ahead and get that proton, and we're going to deprotonate that terminal alkyne to get the acetylide ion. That's why we need to perform this with excess, because if we use a stoichiometric amount, right, if we use two equivalents, we're gonna get a mixture, right? We're not gonna get everything to double dehydrohalogenate, because some of them are gonna go three reactions with base, some of them are gonna go two, some of them are gonna go one. So we need to use excess and push this all the way to the acetylide ion so that we have all acetylide ions in solution. So that's why we need excess. And then once we're at the acetylide ion, we can just go ahead and finish our alkyne synthesis. We can just do some aqueous acidic workup, right? So just whatever that is, and we can go ahead and get just our terminal alkyne, right? We can get a terminal alkyne that way. We would just protonate that. This would just be our workup step at the end of the reaction. Just throw some ammonium chloride in there, whatever it is. And we've got our terminal alkyne there. But I do want to show you one other interesting thing we can do with an acetylide ion, because this can certainly act as a base. But an acetylide ion, because of the formal negative charge and because of the shape, it's almost bullet-shaped because it's linear, right? So we have this carb anion, and then we have a triple bond going back here. So there's no steric hindrance, so it's actually a very good nucleophile, and we can actually do SN2 with an acetylide ion. So we could just as well as aqueous workup, we could just do an SN2 with, say, an alkyl halide. That would be a common SN2 electrophile. So why don't we just go ahead and we'll go over here, we'll attack there, we'll kick that off. And so what we've done is we've attached a three-carbon fragment, right? One, two, three, right? That's these carbons, one, two, three, to the end of this acetylide ion. So this would be the new bond. This would be the new bond that was formed in doing so. So this red bond right there represents this arrow. That's where the acetylide ion attacked this three-carbon molecule. And so that's just another thing that we can do. And now we've got this symmetric alkyne. We've got this fully substituted alkyne. So using a geminal dihalide that's alpha to the terminus, we have two options. We can go ahead and get our terminal alkyne with just aqueous acidic workup, or we can do an SN2 and we can get a fully substituted alkyne. And so these are some different ways that we can make alkynes. Thanks for watching, guys. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, professordaveexplains@gmail.com.